Talking about this book called Selfie that I've been reading by Will Storr. I've been banging on about it the last couple of episodes, so please forgive I, but I've been on a bit of a reading tear, as you can tell, just back on Instagram, so you can tell where I've been spending my time. So I'm reading this book called Selfie by Will Storr. Amazing book. It's the subtitle, How the West Became Self-Obsessed. If you're interested in that topic, I recommend you check it out. Well, there's a really heart-wrenching story towards the back of the book, right, where Will Storr talks about this guy that he meets called Austin Hines, right, who is an investor in this startup, and he says something, you know, out of turn during an interview, and, you know, the cancel culture dumpster fire of League of Journalists out there decided to take his word out of context, run a, you know, a smear campaign against him, and essentially shame him out of existence, right, which eventually leads to him committing suicide. It's a really gut-wrenching story, but also it goes to show the complete lack of accountability in social media nowadays, right? Or in cancel culture in general. I have a theory that cancel culture is kind of done. I think nowadays the prevalence of it has sort of waned a little bit. The reactions aren't as rich, aren't as visceral as they used to be. People are a little bit more hesitant to kind of really pile on unless the pile on is necessary. People are able to bounce back more often than not. There isn't a complete blanket ban and chucking out of things and deplatforming and taking off your name off the wall. If that's not the same thing anymore, now it's sort of like measured a little bit. But I have a feeling that if this would happen nowadays, this story, right, this article from Inc. that kind of talks about it, I think this journalist would have been in more trouble now that it happened now, honestly. Because, again, there's this idea on the left, especially with liberals or with people, you know, not liberals, well, with people on the kind of fringes of the left wing of politics, which I'm not really a big fan of, I don't try and get involved in, but just from observing what's going on in the, you know, in the screaming matches on Twitter and stuff, there is this idea on the left that words are violent, right? There is this idea that words can be triggering, right? They can lead to episodes of depression, anxiety, PTSD. They can be abusive, whatever it is, right? There's this really bizarre word that somehow words are violence, which, you know, if you've been suggested any kind of violence or you've grown up in a violent area, you'll know that that suggestion is bizarre. But if words are violent, which let's agree with that notion is true, then wouldn't it be also within reason to say that this journalist has some kind of culpability or responsibility for this guy eventually killing himself? You'd think that, right? But no, because this journalist in the follow-up article, so, you know, in the book, Will Storr details the entire scenario that kind of led to this guy's suicide, right? He went to a press conference. He was at a press conference. Austin Hines was an investor in a startup. He said something untoward on a stage during a demonstration for the service or product, whatever it is that they were doing. A journalist heard it, misinterpreted it, or purposely misinterpreted it, spread the news or written an article about it on the internet. It then caught wildfire. The other kind of counterculture platforms then decided to take a hold of it as well, like Salon and all those kind of places, and Vox ran stories, besmirched him, smeared him, until a point where he felt as if like he had no way out, and he hanged himself, right, in the same building where his startup that he invested in was based. So imagine people finding his body, right, as he's hanged himself. So the follow-up article from this journalist who wrote the first article and maybe the second follow-up to kind of really smirch him, this is the headline that he uses. Imagine this guy's now dead, right? This is in 2017, I think, or May 2018. This article and the headline on Inc. says, why we need to talk more about mental illness in tech and business. Like, what? Imagine the gumption, the balls on somebody to title an article that eventually an article kind of, you know, off the back of somebody that they smeared in public has killed himself, committed suicide, and the first thing you want to write is that. Shouldn't the title be, I'm sorry, full stop? Right? Again, you can't, I'm not going to put all the blame on the dude, right? I'm sure you probably feel shitty about it, but to somehow completely remove yourself from the situation and say it was an episode of mental health illness that kind of led to it, and to kind of now decide you're now the spokesperson of mental health in tech and business? Come on, dude, jump over a hill. Mamma mia, right? So, this is by an article by Jeff Berkovici, right? And it says the following. I'll read it to you quickly and then we can kind of move on because it's a bit of a harrowing story. So it says the following. Last November at a tech conference in Silicon Valley, I met an entrepreneur named Austin Hines. He was there to talk about this biotech company, Cambrium Genomics, right? Genomics. And some products it was working on. One of them, a probiotic supplement called Sweet Peach. that would change the smell of women's vaginas sound astonishingly sexist, right? Which is really crazy. Why would it be sexist for a guy to make to invest into a company that's trying to change the scent of women's vaginas? Usually, most times, right? Again, it sounds crass and whatever it may do, but usually in tech, usually in that kind of startup environment, they're usually starting the good companies, you know, the ones that are trying to really make the big bucks and quote unquote change the world. They're usually starting their apps based off a need that already exists, right? They're trying to fulfill, they're trying to solve the need, right? They're trying to help people out, bridge the gap. Uber, Airbnb, whatever, Amazon, whatever it may be, they're trying to service a need that exists that no one's actually found an answer for most of the time. So if a guy is deciding to front this company, he's not even the main dude, but he's been in front of it, speaking about it, the spokesperson, it comes from this idea in women's circle that they want their vagina to smell a different way, right? So for instance, this kind of logic, it doesn't make sense, because if a dude decided to start up the first company that made, service women for processes of, I don't know, vaginal rejuvenation, right? Or whatever it may be. And he decided, you know, he went to Africa, he saw these women that were had vaginas mutilated through torture and whatever in regard, or he was just like a dude from the hills that wanted to expand his, you know, cosmetic surgery offerings and decided to then venture into vaginas. Would that be sexist? What the fuck does that mean? What, so you can't invent something or provide a service for a gender or race or people that you're not a part of? That doesn't make any sort of sense. Like, what? So what, should we not use iPhones because Steve Jobs wasn't black? Like, all right, cool. Immediately, dickhead. It immediately put me in the mind of horror stories I've heard about what it's like to be a woman in Silicon Valley. Again, this is a dude. It's always dudes that do this. It's always, it's never the person that should be offended that's the one like flying the flag. When it is the person, I've got a little more sympathy and I can kind of listen to it, right? So when Carlos Maz is having his beef with Steven Crowder, even though he's being annoying, I can get his point, right? Because it does seem like Steven Crowder is purposely picking on him and just probing the bear, poking the bear. Now he's responded back also to Steven Crowder as a spokesperson for free speech. I understand it can be annoying for Carlos Maz, but it's from him, right? He's a queer dude who's kind of feeling like this guy's kind of poking fun at him because of his sexuality and because of his political leanings. No problem. But when it's a guy standing up for a women's, what? What? Let the women come up and say the sexist, say, oh my god, this is horrible, why don't they, cool. But that is not even a conversation here. Like, it's just a bizarre thing. Anyway, it continues. I was watching her presentation and following up with him on one-to-one. I wrote a breezy article poking fun at Heinz. Poking fun? No, you didn't. You ripped into pieces. And his idea, it went moderately viral, very viral, and caused some problems for Heinz. Problems, more than fucking problems, who it emerged was only a minor investor in Sweet Peach and had mischaracterized it significantly. In a follow-up interview, he expressed regret, but also told me the controversy would be great for Sweet Pea, which is true. With Sweet Peach, like, controversy sells. He's trying to justify, like, oh, he knew what he was getting himself into. No, he didn't, you fucking idiot. That's why you raised $10 million, because shit happens. That conversation deepened my impression of Heinz as someone who sought to be provocative and either didn't care or didn't realize how he came across. Again, you didn't care about how much weight your words had, did you, either? In late April, I had my next and last contact with Heinz while reporting his magazine feature on biotech startups backed by Peter Thiel, a group that included Cambrian Genomics. I asked to interview him for the story. Understandably reluctant to speak to me again, he agreed to answer a few questions by email. His replies were curt. On Thursday, I learned Steve Austin Heinz committed suicide. A few weeks after our email exchange, I found out about his death from an article in Business Insider, which said he had a history of mental health illnesses. Okay, cool. He's already trying to cop, please. Bipolar disorder that was among the diagnoses he had been given by psychiatrists. Of course, coping, please. This guy's and there's perfectly functioning people out there with bipolar and mental health illnesses living life well and keeping their mental health issues under wraps for the most part. They might have episodes where they freak out, but for the most part, they're able to live with it. To somehow suggest that was the main reason why he killed himself is obscene considering what he writ, right? So just a guy lacking any kind of moral compass in any way, shape or form, any kind of compassion or empathy. It's fucking bizarre, right? Bipolar disorder was among the diagnoses he'd been given by a psychiatrist. According to a semi-anonymous memoir he published, Business Insider quoted a friend of Heinz, Mike Alfred, who said my articles and official coverage there attracted weighed heavily on Heinz's mind in his final moments. Andy reported he felt like garbage upon learning that someone to whom he'd been professionally unkind had taken his life. I probably feel more garbage than most. 7 years ago, my younger sister... Oh, yeah. So, again... That's what I mean, right? So he's just copying, please. No way. I haven't searched the article. Did he say sorry? All the same, I'm sorry I didn't. Sorry I didn't what? Anyway, this guy's a piece of shit, Jeff Bogosian. And again, just goes to show the lack of understanding nowadays when it comes to the weight of your words on social. If we, you know, jokingly tell each other that people exist only on social media and addicted to it, and there's books I'm reading like, you know, Digital Minimalism by Cal Newport that argue that we should, you know, remove ourselves from our smartphones and detach ourselves from social media in order to live more fulfilling lives. If that's an actual thing, and he's got a whole book that kind of details the practices and the projects you need to do in order to kind of break free from that digital handcuffs, right? So we know it's some kind of addiction that's akin to drugs and alcohol. If that's the issue, if that's true, then why it should be no surprise that somebody that lives entirely on there, whose reputation is entirely framed by the things they do on social media, would think that there's no other way out for themselves if they've been backed into a corner other than taking their own life because somebody wrote a bad article about them. It should make complete sense. It shouldn't be that far-fetched. It shouldn't be like, oh, this no words don't matter. Yeah, they do. You just said it, right? You just said these people on social, the left-wing people are like, you know, words matter and words can be violent. Okay, cool. If that's true, when you write an article, you know, smearing somebody, be, I don't know, cognitive that it might go left. It could go left really quickly. It might not. Hopefully it doesn't, but it could. Be responsible for your words. But instead, no, you don't get nothing. You get this guy title. Again, maybe it's not him titling it, but it's like, we need to talk about mental health. No, we don't need to talk about it. You weren't interested in it before you read the article. You didn't care. It's just insane. Insane, the level of fucking empathy that exists on the internet. It's just bizarre, to say the least. Like, it's like, huh? Especially for the people that are meant to be understanding of the various facets and be a little bit more nuanced and have all the information, they, you know, journalists and commentators and media figures, they should be the ones that are a little bit more hesitant to kind of jump out there and be knee-jerk. But if anything, they're the ones that cause the knee-jerk, right? They're instant kind of panic and, you know, outlandish comments are what kind of set the tone all around the world, right? It's like when Reza Aslan posted that picture of that that kid that was wearing the MAGA hat and he was kind of standing in front of the Native American dude. The first thing he posted, this kid has the most punchable face. Like, you're Reza Aslan. How old are you, man? How old's that kid? You're posting a picture of some random dude wearing a hat smiling at a Native American guy and saying he's got a punchable face. Like, what? And that just set the conversation for the whole thing, right? Then it kind of transpired that whatever the Native American dude was saying was a complete lie, which no one really followed up on. It's like, wow, insane. Insane world you live in, man. But again, RIP to Austin Hines. Like, sad turn of events. But again, I hope now we see a change in this whole cancel culture thing and things start to move in a different direction, because it's getting a bit boring, isn't it, really? Isn't it? All this outrage. Like, everyone's upset about something. Like, god damn it, man. Be upset about other things. I should be upset about my glasses nearly breaking just there. Nearly actually breaking. Yeah. What do I know?